And I am so excited to welcome you all. And it is my pleasure to have Rupal Patel here with us to talk about resilience, which has been a very topical term, idea, I think, in this past year. It is very much a salve that I personally have been looking for. I'm very excited to have our expert here to talk to us about resilience and how you can use it in your life and in your work. So it is my pleasure to turn the controls over to Rupal.
Hello, everyone, and welcome from wherever in the world you're joining from. So Linda and Sam, it looks like it's a beautiful day there in sunny Chicago. I'm joining you all from London, and I imagine that there, you know, given the breadth of the Chicago family, there are those of you who are joining from all four corners of the world. So welcome, whatever time it is, whatever meal you're about to go into after we're finished here. And I'm really looking forward to having a really open and a very, again, in the sort of ethos of the University of Chicago Life of the Mind sort of philosophy, a very open and very practical discussion around this topic of resilience, because there are so many things that we all have probably encountered, especially in the past year, where this term and building our own resilience reserves has come up. And this is something we're all really deeply care about. So just a bit of an intro on what to expect from our hour together. First and foremost, I'd just like to ask that you be present. So I appreciate we all have a lot going on, especially working from home, if you've got kids, if you've got other things going on, but you've chosen to be here for the next hour. So if you are here, please just be here. Try to turn off distractions, try to close the door if you can to any potential noise that's coming your way. And I would also, again, to the extent that you will find it useful, would encourage you to take notes, because a lot of what I'll be sharing will have very specific applications to you, your life, your career, what you care about. So try to just take notes throughout the conversation, and also make note of any questions you want to ask, because I'm going to make sure we leave lots of time for Q&A. Be open. So Vegas rules apply. Whatever happens in this Zoom room stays in the Zoom room. So please feel free to share as honestly as you possibly can. I'll be sharing very honestly from my own experiences and the ups and the downs that I faced. And hopefully you'll feel sort of comfortable to do the same. Be you. So again, this goes back to make this relevant to you, however you need to think about this topic, whatever specific aspects of resilience, inner toughness, resolve, whatever you want to call it, whatever aspects of it are most relevant to you, try to reframe the topics and the insights that I'm sharing with you in a way that's going to be as practical for you as possible. And then lastly, I'd like to encourage us all to be a bit more Hollywood. So we are, and by that I mean to suspend disbelief. We all have, you know, again, in the great tradition of UChicago, big brains, really analytical brains. We love to poke holes in things. We love to, you know, rely on our paradigms and heuristics and all of these great things that we've developed over time. But I'd encourage you to just suspend disbelief for the next hour that you're here. Try to leave any baggage, any preconceived notions about yourself, about this topic. Just leave it all outside of this hour and just be as fully sort of in the realm of the here and the now as you possibly can, suspending all of that great cynical disbelief that we've all got. So a bit about me and why I love talking about this topic. I have a slightly non-traditional career, perhaps, than you might expect. After I left Chicago in 2005, I joined the CIA, and that's where I spent about half of my professional career. So during that time, while I was working at the agency, I was working on some of our toughest foreign policy issues, from war zone strategy to working with Congress on some of our covert operations. And throughout that experience, I was constantly finding myself in new, unfamiliar, uncertain, terrifying environments where I had to dig deep, had to find ways to keep going in the face of challenges, to keep going in the face of extended uncertainty of, you know, what's going to happen and how does this play out? And, you know, nobody knows the answer. And I really had to develop my own toolkit, a lot of which I'll be sharing with you, to stay sane, you know, working in an environment where you almost literally can never anticipate what's going to happen next. It's really, really, for me, it was really important to find my own survival mechanisms for developing resilience, developing comfort with discomfort. And again, some of these tools I'll share with you. After I left the agency, I sort of did a total 180 again, and I went and I started a business of my own, totally from scratch, no experience whatsoever in the industry, and built that basically on my own until for the sort of the subsequent 5 or 6 years, at which point I was able to retire my partner and bring him full-time into our business, which he now helps me run. And now a lot of my time is focused on sharing what those lessons I've learned from the agency, from starting my own businesses, from being a leadership and an executive coach for almost 7 years now, and all of the insights that I've developed. So that's sort of where I'm coming from, a bit about my background and why, again, I feel so strongly about resilience and helping all of us tap into the resilience reserves we already have, and also a bit of how I developed the reserves that I draw on now. So a bit of setting the stage about, again, sort of this big topic. You know, resilience can be applied in so many different ways and so many different aspects of our life. And I think, you know, our approach to challenges and uncertainty are going to be specific to us, of course, but there are some general cultural parameters that I think define how we think about challenge, uncertainty, difficult periods, failure, setbacks, all of those things that would require us to be resilient in the face of. So I think very broadly, culturally speaking, you know, we have a fear of failure and a fear of the unknown. Again, we're great Chicagoans. We like answers. We like, yes, sort of thinking about problems, but we like to debate them. We like to have answers and come up with a solution and feel like we're right. You know, we've gotten to the core of the problem. And while that's great and it makes for very active and intellectual engagement with the world, there's also this element, I think, sometimes of being afraid of the unknown. And it can be intellectual unknown, it can be emotional, it can be physical, it can be career-wise, you know, with relationships, whatever it is. But I think, again, we all sort of share to some extent this fear of failure and fear of the unknown. You know, we're all high achievers, go-getters. Again, we wouldn't have been part of the Chicago family if we didn't have, you know, excellence in our blood. And that can also be a bit of a, you know, set us up for some real sort of slaps in the face with reality when we do face failure for the first time, when we're not the smartest person in the room, when we're not the biggest brain, when we're not the most capable. And that fear, I think, can really hobble the way we look at challenge and almost make us shrink from uncertainty and things that we're not the experts at. There's also this idea of admiring the problem, right? Again, we've got these amazing analytical brains. We love to stare and to stew and to obsess over the problem and look at it from every specific potential angle. But it creates a little bit of paralysis because we're so consumed with the problem that we're not thinking bigger and more broadly about a potential solution sometimes, or just being able to step back and get a bit of perspective. And we get used to this sort of loop of just admiring the problem and obsessing over the problem itself, which of course can lead to analysis paralysis, right? We've all perhaps, again, to some extent, faced this issue where we want more information, we want better information, we just want to consume as much data and input as we possibly can so we feel confident that we're making the perfect decision. But perfect decisions don't exist in the real world. And analysis paralysis is a very, very real thing. Again, especially for people like us who have, you know, careers and academic backgrounds where that is something that we are taught and we try to train. And then another thing that I think we don't often think about is the history and the paradigms and the specific tapes that we reach for, the habits, for example, that we reach for when we are faced with challenge or uncertainty. For some people, you know, in the face of an obstacle, they bury their heads in the sand. For others, they sort of, you know, charge forward without thinking about it and just leap before they look, and they, you know, sort of, it creates a different sort of extreme reaction in them. But you know for yourself what that tape is that you reach for. When you have a difficult problem, when you have some obstacle you're facing, when you have something that hasn't gone your way, when you're facing uncertainty, there's a certain tape we all reach for. You know, again, it goes back to heuristics and shortcuts and all of that great stuff that we develop over time and experience. But sometimes those tapes don't serve us, and we don't realize that we're playing that tape until someone perhaps points it out to us, or we finally come to a point where we're like, gosh, this tape is just not doing any good for me anymore. And then lastly, you know, sort of related to the tapes that we play, some of them aren't our own. Some of them are ones that we've inherited perhaps from, you know, our families, people who've told us certain things about ourselves, or teachers or partners or, you know, strangers perhaps, who give us a lot of what I would like to refer to as mental baggage. Right? They tell us, you know, this is what you are good at, this is what you're not good at, this is the category you belong to, this is the label that we're giving you, this is, you know, your skills and your assets, these are the things that you need to work on. And we take all of these things, and sometimes we assume them to be true, even when they're not true. And all of this baggage really starts to weigh us down. And then when we do face an uncertain period in our lives or we face something new or challenging, we think, oh gosh, like all of those things that those people said about me that I believe to be true, actually, are they true? You know, and we don't ever really spend time unpacking that and analyzing, well, is it actually true? You know, the things that we're telling ourselves about, you know, how strong we are, how weak we are, how resilient we are, how adaptable we are, those things that we say to ourselves and we've assumed to be true, where are those assumptions coming from? What's beneath those assumptions? And I think it's really important that we take time to, again, unpack and critically analyze and see what is true what versus what isn't true, and also to see what rings true for us versus what others have told us is true about us. So this is the general sort of crazy mental, cerebral setting we're all facing, we're operating in, when we have, you know, in our day-to-day lives, and especially these come to the fore, again, when we face a challenge or a period of uncertainty. And what happens because of so all of this combined, and again, given that we are very analytical, brainy people, we just get stuck in our heads. Not always, and I'm not, you know, again, there will always be exceptions for each of us or for, you know, in certain scenarios, but a lot of times what ends up happening is that we get stuck in our heads. And we really need to break the pattern of getting stuck in our heads when we do face a challenge. And again, playing those tapes, those same paradigms, those same heuristics over and over, and finding ways to get out of our heads. So what can we do about it, right? Because this is hopefully going to be a very solutions-based and a very toolkit-focused sort of hour that we spend together. I think one of the biggest things that we need to do is force ourselves, however it needs to happen, to get back into the world and out of our heads, out of the thinking and into the doing. So one of the very specific ways we can do that is to make it concrete. Now, when you face a challenge or a fear or an anxiety or an uncertainty, the tendency often is to just think about it in the abstract. But when we make it concrete, we can effectively do what I refer to as naming the beast, right? Let's say, I don't know, you're putting yourself up for promotion and you're really, really, or you want to, and you're really terrified about it. You know, again, you're going into that loop of, oh, I should do it, shouldn't do it for this reason. And it's really risky for that reason. And, you know, maybe I'll get knocked down and maybe I'll get rejected and all of these things. We spin that loop in our heads, perhaps. But if we really make that anxiety concrete, what is it that we're actually worried about when we pull ourselves back from putting ourselves forward for promotion? What is the specific beast that we're grappling? Is it that we don't have the confidence? Is it that we don't have the skills? Is it that, you know, we don't think our boss likes us enough and is not going to be an objective party in assessing our application? What specifically is it that we're worried about, anxious about, etc.? And then once you know what that beast is specifically, then you can take steps to address that specific challenge instead of just saying, oh, well, you know what? I'm not going to put myself forward for this promotion because I'm just terrified of it. So making it very concrete and specific is one way of getting out of our heads and going back into the practical world about what we can do and what we can control. The other thing that I think is important that we do very specifically is basically play out that worst case scenario. Again, anytime we're afraid of something or worried about something or in extended periods of uncertainty, again, COVID has been basically a year-long exercise in living with uncertainty, right? What we have all worried about so many different things at different points. But when you are in the midst of that worry, what is the absolute worst case scenario that you're worried about, right? Again, more often than not, we stick to our heads and we keep it in our heads and we don't make it concrete and very specific. But if we play out that worst case scenario, we'll see more often than not that it gets pretty ridiculous when we play it to the most logical end, right? So taking that example of putting yourself forward for a promotion, let's say you're afraid that you'll get rejected. Okay, well, then what happens? Well, you get rejected, then you're stuck at working that same job that you've always been in, and you might be a bit personally humiliated. Okay, well, what's the worst that happens from that? Well, you know, you might feel a little bit of embarrassment. It might be a bit of a knock to your ego, but specifically, you know, what's the worst that's going to happen to that? And just keep playing it to, you know, that sort of exercise of infinite regress, right? And you'll see at the very core, more often than not always, but more often than not, either the very worst, the very rock bottom end of that worst case scenario is either really ridiculous or unfounded, or it's something that you can manage and you can handle. For a lot of people, you know, playing that worst case scenario tape to the end might be, you know, I lose, again, speaking professionally, it might be, oh, I lose my job, or, you know, I go bankrupt if I take this, you know, this next really exciting opportunity, or whatever it is. But more often than not, that worst case it's not as bad as we imagined it to be before we, you know, sort of made it very practical. And secondly, when we've, again, named that beast, what is the absolute rock bottom? What is the worst case that I am imagining? When we make it very concrete and very specific, more often than not, I would hazard to say probably 99.999% of the time, there are things that we can do very proactively to make sure that it's not that worst case scenario. It's not that rock bottom, or that rock bottom place is something that we can manage and make a little bit less of a horrible scenario. The other thing we can do is to practice the outcome and not the anxiety, right? So again, I think for a lot of people, career anxieties and financial anxieties have been plaguing us all for the past, you know, 12 months or so, that there's been this huge global shock. But what we end up doing is rehearsing the disaster scenario, rehearsing, oh my God, I'm going to lose my job, or my company's going to, you know, sort of make a ton of redundancies, or we're going to have to take pay cuts, or whatever. We play these disaster scenarios in our head, and we rehearse the anxiety over and over, and again, go into this death spiral of just obsessing over that one anxiety. But instead, if we flipped it and practiced the outcome, let's, again, going back to the worst case scenario, okay, well, if my company had redundancies and, you know, I did end up losing my job, what would I do about it? What outcome would I want? Or if it's something, you know, a little bit less extreme, if it's, you just have a fear of public speaking and you know you have to do a presentation, don't practice how nervous you are, because the more you think about how nervous you are, the more nervous you're going to get, right? Our brains are so powerful at when we focus on something, that's what we get. But instead of focusing on the anxiety of that, you know, public presentation that we have to give or whatever it is, if we practice the outcome, if we practice our performance, if we practice the confidence, that's what our brains will lock onto. And that's what will come out of the other end. It's not the, again, that horrible scenario that we need to be practicing. It's what outcome it is that we want, or what the outcome we want to look like, that we should be practicing. And this goes without saying, but it's one of those sort of simple truisms that is so hard to do in reality, is to focus on what you can control. There is always going to be an element, at least one thing that we can do that's in our control to make the things that we're worried about, to make our challenges, to make our setbacks, to make our obstacles, you know, a little bit less about other things or other people. So if we don't obsess over those other things that are outside of our control and refocus on the things that we can control, it just breaks that inertia, and it forces us to, again, think a bit more creatively, because instead of obsessing over everything we can't do, all of a sudden our brains are starting to activate around the things that we can do and the things we can control. And finally, I like to sort of summarize all of this as basically studying the art of the possible, because anytime we face a setback, a challenge, a difficulty, whatever it is, it's so easy to focus on all of the things that we're missing, all of the things that we have, you know, we might lose, we might lack, we might not be able to do, the impossible things in this scenario, whatever the scenario might be. But instead, if we flipped it again on its head and said, you know what? Okay, fine. This is the world that I've been given. How can I make things possible within these parameters? And instead of obsessing over what's impossible, to start studying what is possible. So again, very concretely, one of the ways we can all do this is to do what I refer to as tapping into your success persona. So again, in the intelligence world, you know, personas are a thing. You sort of, you go into a persona for a specific mission, for a specific, you know, sort of interaction, and you really immerse yourself in that. We can all do this. We all have different personas that we effectively put on and shed in different contexts. I'm not talking about, you know, sort of multiple personalities or anything, you know, outlandish. It's literally, we all activate or deactivate certain aspects of who we are and what our personalities are in different environments. And we have all had successes in something, whether it's on, you know, on the football field or in the boardroom setting or at home or in negotiation settings, whatever it is, we all have this success that we've tasted and we've been able to make real for ourselves. So when we're finding ourselves in a point of real difficulty, if we tap into very concretely, very internally, that success persona, you know, what was it like when I was on that football field? What was it like when I was nailing that presentation? What was it like when I did the best, I don't know, sort of performance of the violin concerto of my life? You know, whatever it is where you've experienced a big success, you can put that hat on, that persona on, in a challenging environment. And again, it will create a different mentality and a different optic with which you'll be looking at the challenge in front of you. So again, tap into that persona whenever you need it. also unpacking your fear, right? The title of our session today has been about unpacking resilience, but we also need to be unpacking our fears. And the reason fear is an acronym here is because so often fear is nothing more than a false expectation appearing real. More often than not, we've all done this in the past, we've gotten really spun up about how something is going to turn out, how horrible it's going to be, how we're going to fall flat on our faces, and it's going to suck. And the reality was probably not as bad, right? So we need to consciously remind ourselves that pretty much never are we good at being able to predict the outcome and how bad it's going to be. And to remind ourselves that a lot of the times it is a false expectation that we just assume to be real. We can also learn from others. Again, we're very good at learning, right? We're sort of lifelong learners, big brains, life of the mind, all that great stuff. And if we're in a situation where it's uncomfortable, it's challenging, it's difficult, it's new, we don't have to make it up on our own. We can always learn from others. And it's important that if we do start looking for ideas and learning from other people, that we make sure that the people we are learning from have relevant and qualified information. So it's not, let's say you're finding it really challenging to start a business, you know, from scratch. Don't take advice from your parents or your friends or even people you know who are really smart and work in the business world, because if they have never started a business themselves, they do not have relevant or qualified information to share with you to help you get unstuck. The people you need to be getting the advice and the learnings from are people who have started businesses and have made a success of it. And this sounds like such an obvious point to make, but so often we just take advice from everybody. We take advice because everybody's got it, right? And we forget that they're not everybody is qualified to have the opinion that they have. So if you are looking to learn from other people, make sure they have the qualified and relevant experience that you need to overcome whatever it is that you're facing. This is an interesting one. And I think this is something that this idea of helping others when we're stuck, when we're at our most fragile, when we're at our most vulnerable and feeling, you know, down or whatever it is so helpful to help other people. I think largely because it forces us to get out of our own obsessive, you know, again, death spiral of how hard it is for me and woe is me and the gods have cursed me and I'm uniquely, you know, sort of being singled out to be punished for whatever X, Y, and Z reason. You know, we can get into that crazy, again, death spiral of thinking that we're being targeted and it's only us. But when we help other people, it again brings us out of ourselves and our obsession over ourselves and how hard we have it. It also reminds us that other people are struggling too. We're not alone. We're not uniquely cursed. We're not the only ones who are suffering. Again, with COVID, one of the things that I think for me anyway, that gave me some sort of not comfort, but it gave me some perspective was I knew that everything that I was facing, the financial challenges, the emotional challenges, the family and work-life balance challenges, all of that stuff that we were all, everyone around the world was facing it. It was not just me. It was not just this country. It was not just, you know, a small segment of the population. It was everyone. And we need to keep that perspective from so that we don't sort of shrink into ourselves and curl up in a ball and die. You know, that's not the way it's going to work. And so helping others really helps sort of short circuit that habit of like coming into ourselves and trying to and assuming that we're the only ones who have it bad. The other thing that I think is really helpful that we can all do is to analyze our backstories and when we have overcome challenges. So it's somewhat related to the success persona, but again, I imagine none of us would have gotten to this point in our lives. It doesn't matter if you're in your 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s. After a certain point in your life, you will have come up against some obstacle, some challenge, some period of difficulty where you had to find a way through, and you did. And we often forget that we have this capability in us because we think every scenario is a new one. And yes, while the specifics are new, we're not, we're the same person. So why not use those times where we were successful in the face of challenge, where we did keep going when we wanted to quit, to remind us that we have that power within us. It sounds a little bit sort of woo-woo and out there, but it's true. I think, again, it sort of retrains our brains to focus on the solutions, to focus on what we have got, and then helps us move forward more proactively instead of thinking, again, this whole woe is me thing and just stopping at that. So remind yourself and look and literally sit down if you need to and analyze like, hey, you know, last year I faced this challenge. A couple of years ago, I faced this challenge. This is what I did. This is what worked. This is what doesn't. And then you've developed your own toolkit for when things get tough again in the future. And also make sure you do what I refer to as to sort of implement a sort of tactical ignorance. And by tactical ignorance, I don't mean burying your head in the sand. I mean, being very, very careful and very specific about the inputs that you let into your brain. Our brains are so, so prone to suggestion, to repetition, to all of those great things that, you know, anybody who studies psychology knows. And if we just let all inputs in, it's that thing of garbage in, garbage out, right? But if on the flip side, we're tactically ignorant about certain things, we tactically choose to not research something, certain things, we tactically choose to not let certain inputs in, it really protects our headspace and our brain space and allows, again, for the art of the possible to come more to the fore. Very specifically, for example, you know, during COVID, I made it a point to not watch the news, because especially in the beginning, every day was sky is falling, the whole world is coming to an end, it's a total disaster, everybody run for the hills and, you know, start, go off with your, you know, go live in the woods because that's the only place it's safe, and all of the crazy stories that mask themselves as news. I know that that's just noise to me. I don't need to know how many people are dying around the world because I just know it's happening, right? You don't need to get depressed about, oh shit, today it's a million, yesterday it was however many hundreds of thousands. That information isn't really relevant, and it's just noise. And if it's going to affect your ability to move forward, if it's going to depress you or to stop you or to stunt you in any way, then you know yourself best. You get to decide what you're going to be very tactically ignorant about. For me, it's basically not watching the news, because a lot of the times what masks or what sort of comes across as being news is just the same old crap in a different day, in a different format. So think about the inputs that you're letting in and what impact they're having on your, again, on your ability. Or, you know, putting it very simply, is to separate the noise from the data, right? I don't need to know a play-by-play, day-by-day breakdown of cases and deaths and, you know, spikes and you know, all of this kind of stuff. I just don't need to know that. And this is true for other problems that have nothing to do with global pandemics, right? We don't need to know every single thing about every single thing, even though we might sometimes think we do or want to. So separate the noise from the signal from the noise or the noise from the data. It's a very specific thing because, again, you know what sets you off, you know what you need, but you also need to be very, very protective about the noise and about the data that's coming in. And then to remind yourself about the tools, again, like I said earlier, the tools you already have, right? We all, to some extent, have already faced uncertainty, and we've gotten maybe not totally comfortable with it where we sort of invite it and welcome it, but we've done it in the past. We've faced uncertain challenges. We've faced uncertain times, whether personally, professionally. Anybody who's a parent knows that basically a daily trial and uncertainty, especially in the early days, you never know what you're going to get that day. Is your infant going to sleep? Are they not? You know, whatever it is, you have faced uncertainty before, and you have gotten at least somewhat comfortable with it and been able to roll with the punches. So analyze what you did and how that worked. We're all problem solvers. Again, we've got these great Chicago trained brains, right? Why not train those problem solving skills on the problems we face, on the challenges we face, and use it in every aspect of our lives, not just in one. We're really good at doing preparation and research, right? So again, let's turn that into something that we do to prepare and research how we're going to overcome a challenge, how we're going to move forward in the face of an obstacle, how we're going to be a little bit stronger in the face of the next thing that comes our way. The preparation can come in lots of different forms. It can come, again, from learning from others, from learning from yourself, analyzing your backstory, your personas, all of that great stuff, and then researching the things that are possible, like I said, sort of with this frame of the art of the possible. We're all good analyzers, right? But we need to start doing more of the analysis without the paralysis. And taking a very experimental approach. Like, some responses are going to work in some scenarios and some won't, and some won't. But we have to be willing to try lots of different things in the pursuit of, you know, moving forward, moving onwards, challenging ourselves, growing, et cetera, and not take it all as like this big thing that I have to have the answer right now. That's just not how life works. And also to remind ourselves that sometimes we just have to be our own role model. Because when times get tough, it's so easy to just be like, I can't do this. I can't. I don't have the capacity. I don't have the tools. I've never done this before. It's terrifying. It's scary, et cetera. That all might be true. But sometimes you owe it to yourself to be this example that you want for yourself. Again, with COVID, you know, there were probably many times where, whether it was a personal or familial or health related, whatever challenge you faced, that you wanted to curl up into a ball and just make it all go away and or sort of wish it all away. But it didn't happen, right? You did something. So remind yourself of that. Remind yourself of when you were at your best, when you were facing these challenges, and that you can sort of move forward doing things that scare you, because then you can at least prove it to yourself that you're capable of it, and you can start to be the role model that you are looking for instead of always looking outward for it. So some of these self-focused tools that I've shared with you, I've made them very, very self-focused, because we all respond to things differently. We all need things a little bit differently. And hopefully you'll find your own ways to adapt some of these tools and these ideas in your own life. Again, whether it's for a personal challenge, a career challenge, a relationship one, a financial one, whatever it is, you can use these in different ways. But again, I highly encourage you to study your personas, whether it's your success persona, your negotiations persona, your parenting persona, your best friend persona, whatever it is, and then use the right persona for the task at hand. It sounds a little bit weird, but you have to practice doing it. Again, it goes back to that experimental approach, right? Study your backstory and be willing to learn from yourself, because this might sound a little bit cheesy, but more often than not, we have the answers. We are just not willing to look hard enough within ourselves to find them. So if you make an analytical study of your own backstory, of your own challenges, your own setbacks, your own times when you felt resilient, when you proved to yourself you could do something you never thought you could, and then analyze it, break it down, what you did specifically, that will give you the toolkit that you need for the next time. Hack your SOPs. We all have these. Like I said, I call them earlier, I call them tapes, you know, that we play again and again and again. Well, okay, well, this is the scenario. I'm going to reach for that tape. Oh, this is a difficulty. I'm going to reach for that tape, right? But you can hack that. That doesn't, just because that's how you were, doesn't mean that's how you always have to be. I know for me, for example, that when I find something challenging or frustrating, or I've had a setback, or someone said no to something, or, you know, there's been a period of difficulty in my life, I know that my tape is to just get really angry and to get really just fuming and cursing into the wind about the other person, this, you know, who did that and whose fault it is. And again, I go into that same death spiral. And there was a time where that would last for days. And it's exhausting to always be angry and frustrated and mad at other people or other things outside of your control. So what I did to hack my own standard operating procedure was I limited how long I would let myself be in that state. So I decided at some point, it was probably, I think 2013, 2014, when I was first building my business, and there was just one thing after another, after another, after another. And I was like, it is too exhausting to be this frustrated and this angry and this sort of down about things out of my control for this long. So what I decided I was going to do is literally to put a time limit on it. The next time I faced a challenge or some, you know, some difficulty or something that went wrong and that was going to be, you know, really, really time consuming to fix, instead of stewing on it and being angry and frustrated and mad about it for days, I gave myself a deadline. I started out sort of a bit more kindly to myself. And I was like, you know what, just take today. Just take one full day where you're pissed off and you're really going to just sort of stew in how frustrated you are. And then after today is over, you're done. You never get to think about it again in this way. From tomorrow onwards, you're going to focus on the solutions and the next steps. And then I shrank that time to the point where now literally I set my alarm for 30 minutes. Anytime something pisses me off or something makes me really, really angry, or there's been a big challenge, I let myself stew in it and fume about it and get really angry for 30 minutes. And then the second that clock or that alarm goes off after 30 minutes, I move on to the solutions and what I'm going to do about it. You can do similar hacks to your own ways of doing things. You know what they are. For some people, they need external accountability. For other people, they might need to just, again, sort of vent it first and then sort of come back to themselves. But think about what it is that you need and how you can hack your own SOP so you're not constantly going to the same tape again and again. And then capture your year. This is something I actually started doing a few years ago now, and it's been hugely helpful. And it's not just with, you know, things like COVID, but every year is such a fertile time period for learning, for growth, for proving to ourselves that we can do things we never thought we could. But we never take time to actually capture it and distill it into certain lessons or takeaways or whatever it is. And so what I do every December, or it's usually sometimes end of November, early December, I look back at the year ahead, all the things that went right, all the things that went wrong, all of the things I did, all of the things I didn't do, or all of those things. And I just distill it into about 10 lessons learned. And it can be lessons about myself. It can be lessons about the world. It can be lessons about other people, whatever it is. But I capture my year every year so that no year feels like a waste. I hear so many people saying, oh, well, 2020 was a write-off. It wasn't a write-off, you guys. that was still 12 months where we did things, we persisted, we survived, some of us may have thrived, we got through hard times, and why just throw it away? Yeah, it wasn't great, it wasn't easy, but we can't just throw it away because we lived it. And if we do just throw it away, that's a huge wasted opportunity for remembering the things that we did do well and that we could learn from and use in the future. So I'd encourage you, if it works for you, to just try every year to capture your year. And I promise you, you will be amazed at how much you learn and how much you grow in a single year. And then build a trophy chest. This goes back a little bit to that idea of a success persona, but some of us need visual reminders of the things that, you know, when things get tough, it's nice to have visual reminders that we don't suck at everything, that we're not total failures, that one no doesn't mean we're a total disaster as a professional or as a person or as a parent, right? But we never take time to, again, to make very concrete and go have a place perhaps that we can go to remind ourselves of the things that we do well. So whether it's emails, you know, an email folder where you can save all of, you know, positive client testimonials or actual things on your desk, awards that you've won, I don't know, medals that you've won, trophies that you, whatever it is, it can be tangible or intangible, but build a trophy chest for yourself so that when times do get tough, when you do feel stuck, like, oh my gosh, I can't do this. I can't move forward. This is all too hard for me. I don't have the capacity. You can remind yourself that you're actually really good at a lot of things. And again, it goes back to experimenting and learning, right? I've shared with you some of the things that I have worked on for years and years and years, and I've shared with others and it's worked brilliantly for them, but you don't know how it's going to work for you unless you try it. And you have to take this experimental, this very light approach to like any challenge, any problem, but also some of the ways that you approach them and be willing to learn from them. So just to sort of review some of the tools, I guess, to help us reset our minds around challenge, failure, uncertainty, difficulties, and setbacks, is what I shared just a few minutes ago about putting a stop loss order on worry. So any of you who work, you know, in the markets know what a stop loss order is. It's basically, you know, sort of limiting your downside. The way I put a stop loss order on my worry or my anxiety or frustration is, like I said, I put a time limit on it. I say 30 minutes and I'm done. You can do the same thing. You can choose to put a very practical boundary around the time that you will let yourself be, you know, down or frustrated or whatever it is. And you have to just make that choice. Remember to study the art of the possible and learn from other people as well. Just make sure that they are qualified and can give you relevant experience and advice. To employ or deploy, I guess, tactical ignorance, to remind ourselves that not all inputs are created equal, and there is a lot of noise out there. You have to decide what it is that you need to leave out in order to protect yourself and move forward. And also to remind ourselves that we can literally, the only thing we can do is what we is you know, focus on what we can control. We cannot control other people. We cannot control viruses. We cannot control weather. We can control a lot of stuff. So just remind ourselves to focus on what we can control in whatever scenario we're grappling with. And it's that narrow, broad paradox, right? So we have to very narrowly focus on our specific scenario, analyze what we can do, study the art of the possible, all of that good stuff, but then also look bigger, right? This gets back to that idea of helping other people. We need to focus on ourselves, yes, like lasers, but we also need to remind ourselves that it's a lot bigger than just us. And study yourself. I know, again, this come up sort of pretty consistently throughout, you know, our time together so far, but you have so many of the tools within you, but I can almost guarantee that not any of us spends as much time studying ourselves as we probably spent studying for our degrees or our PhDs or whatever it is that we do or our current jobs, right? But if we start making a practice of studying ourselves, we can see that a lot of the tools that we're looking elsewhere for, we've already got. And I've given you some ways of doing that. And this is something that I think is really important to remind ourselves, is to pursue aliveness instead of happiness. It's, you know, in the American Constitution, you know, it's enshrined this idea of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But happiness is so fleeting, you know, but and it's so, a lot of it is outside of our control. Some of it, of course, inner happiness and all of that philosophical stuff is in our control, of course. But what if instead of looking for external happiness and external everything and happiness for its own sake, we pursued aliveness instead? So it's to acknowledge the fact that life isn't just happiness, right? Like it's ups and downs. It's a roller coaster. It's the good and the bad. It's the challenges and the successes. And by pursuing aliveness, I think it helps us, again, reframe how we approach every day. Yes, when things are really tough and they suck, it's okay because you can be really fully alive in that suckiness and in that difficulty. It doesn't mean that we enjoy it, but it means that we're grownups about acknowledging the fact that this is just life. And we can either get frustrated when we're unhappy, or we can acknowledge the fact that this is just part of what it means to be human, challenges, good stuff, bad stuff, all of that, and then pursue aliveness and really feeling and being in that moment. Not, again, not to obsess, not to stay stagnant, but to just acknowledge that this is just another experience. And there's nothing objectively necessarily good or bad about it, aside from how I'm thinking about it and what I'm going to do about it. So, you know, I think when we think about this idea of resilience, so many people think about it, it's like being tough and it's being strong. And yes, it's all of those things, but you don't have to be fearless in order to be brave or strong. Because if you don't have any fears, then you can't be brave, right? You wouldn't be brave if you weren't scared. So it's that, again, that paradox of like, in order to be brave, you have to have fear. And that's really all bravery is having fear still riding on your back, but finding a way to move forward anyway. And also to remind ourselves again that we can do hard things. You have done hard things in the past, and you can continue to persevere, to move forward, to be as resilient as you choose to be, because you get to choose what it all means. When you face a difficulty, when you face a challenge, when you face someone saying no or slamming at the door, you know, metaphorically or physically, you get to choose what it means. You get to choose to interpret it as, I'm uniquely cursed, I should give up, I suck, I failed, I'm horrible, I. Or you can choose to think, well, you know what? Maybe that person was having a bad day. Or you know what? This is just sort of part of the game. Rejection is just what it means to be alive. Success and failure is what it means to be, you know, a business owner or a professional, whatever it is. You get to choose what it means. So to the extent that you need some sort of help or concrete ideas to help implement what I've shared with you today, again, play around with these ideas, try some of them, all of them, whatever it is. But I'd encourage you to start putting together your trophy chest. You'd be amazed at how many things that you are really, really good at and you've forgotten about. Practice getting into your success persona. So next time you need to go into a board meeting or into a difficult meeting or, you know, putting yourself or debating whether to put yourself up for a promotion or have a challenging conversation with a partner, whatever it is. Practice getting into your success persona. Remember those successes you've had, those glory moments, whatever you want to call them, and get into that headspace before you go into that sort of challenging environment. Capture the lessons you learned at least from last year. And again, I would encourage you to try to make this a practice every year because it's hugely, hugely valuable. And remember that when things get tough or awkward or difficult, you guys, giving up is always an option. It's always an option. You can always choose to fold your cards, throw in your towel, whatever metaphor you want to use. That is an option, right? But is it an option for you? Are you the type of person who does give up? I imagine not, right? If you're thinking about these topics, I imagine that's not something that's in your sort of vocabulary to give up. So if you're not going to give up, then focus on what you are going to do instead of admire the problem. Because that's the cruel trick of resilience and inner strength, right? You cannot have it unless it's not like a thing that you're born with and you get to employ it anytime you need it. It's one of those things that's only developed in an environment of stress, of failure, of setbacks, and moving forward despite those failures, setbacks, and challenges. And that's how you develop your resilience muscles. So in order to do that, again, here are a couple of ideas, perhaps homework exercises, whatever you want to call that, to sort of start developing your resilience muscle a bit more, is to do what I like to refer to as a go for a 50 rejection challenge. This came to me from a wonderful woman who's an opera singer. And she was saying that, you know, the life of an opera singer is so hard because you're constantly going to auditions and you get rejection after rejection after rejection. This is true in pretty much every industry, right? But she was an opera singer and it was very... It was a great way that she sort of shared with me to think about it. And she said, you know, I decided one day that I'm going to reward myself for staying in the game long enough to have gotten rejected at least 50 times. So every time she got rejected 50 times, she would buy herself a present or give herself some sort of a reward. And it flipped this idea of rejection on its head, because all of a sudden it wasn't, oh my God, I should give up being a soprano. It was, you know what, there's competition and you don't win them all. So I'm just going to stay in the game and reward myself for staying in the game despite the challenges. And so if that works for you, I would highly encourage you to do it, because to be honest, I mean, we all know it, right? With job applications, university applications, dating, all of these things in our lives, a lot of it is just a numbers game. You have to go through all of the no's before you get to the yes. And getting through no after no after no and still trying to get that yes, that's resilience. That's building that muscle. make a plan for those challenges and failures. Not that we can anticipate all of them, but there are some things that we can foresee, or that we can, you know, at least with some degree of safety, assume is going to happen. So don't just sort of go off into the void and be like, okay, world, throw your worst at me. If there are certain challenges or setbacks that you anticipate, certain sort of stumbling blocks or certain things that you know are going to happen again and again, make a plan for what you're going to do so you have something to fall back on. And it, you know, like I shared just a few minutes ago, it's so important to reframe challenges and failures and decide what we're making it mean. It can mean everything or it can mean nothing. Literally, the choice is ours. And then conduct after action reviews. So again, this is something that we did a lot at the agency, right? When there was something that went really well or something that went really horribly, we would see, you know, sort of effectively dissect it and, you know, sort of like an autopsy, right? We can all do that for everything in our lives where we felt like it was something big that affected us, and both the things that went well and the things that didn't work very well. And then we can learn from that and make sure we don't make the same mistakes again. And then we just got to repeat it. Because as I said, that is the cruel trick of resilience and inner strength. You don't just get to have it and then use it whenever you need it. You have to develop it in an environment of stress. So repeat. I hope that some, all of that is stuck. I would love to hear your questions because this is such a big topic and there are so many different ways that we can think about it. So thank you for sharing your morning, afternoon, or evening with me, wherever you are in the world. And I'd love to hear some questions from you if you guys have any. Thank you so much.
Thank you. That was excellent. I know I have a sticky note full of notes on my desktop that I plan to keep and review. Cool. We have a few questions in the chat. I'm going to read some of these. Continue to drop your questions. There's some really great ones in here. We have a question about managing resiliency specifically in the face of experiencing aggressive behaviors. If you have any advice on how to react to aggression specifically.
Oh, that's a big one. Do you know, I think, okay, so there's a lot. It's good. Well, I don't know if this person is talking about it personally or professionally or whatever it is. I think, again, some of it is really, so sort of mentally speaking, it's going back to that idea of like, well, what am I making this mean? Am I making it mean that I am weak and I suck and this person is, you know, can dominate me? Or is it, to be honest, more often than not, especially if it's, you know, well, all aggression is uncalled for, but especially in a professional environment, it's usually about the other person wanting to sort of prove themselves or to effectively try to, you know, make other people, to make themselves feel better by making other feel small. So it's, some of it is just that internal exercise of reminding yourself, like, look, this is a lot, this behavior says a lot more about that person than it does about me. So it's just first and foremost, you know, making sure that that's your starting point. But then secondly, it's that thing of like, well, what can I control? You can't control their aggressive behavior, but you can control your response to it. You can control, again, whether it's I don't know the specifics of this, of the aggression, but if it's appropriate, could you report it? You know, is there, you know, whether if it's at work, is this behavior appropriate for work? And if not, is there someone that you can report it to at HR or whatever else? If it's something that you feel like you want to confront that person about, then what can you do about that? How can you train yourself? And how can you, you know, again, perhaps work with somebody else to work through like, okay, well, I'm going to confront this person and this is what I need to do. Let's almost role play it, right? But it's flipping it again, instead of just feeling like a victim to this person's aggression, is like, what proactive steps can I take? Now, ladies, this is, I have to make a bit of a caveat here because, and maybe it's true for men as well, but my optic is obviously very specific to women. Depending on the scenario and depending on where you're at, your physical safety sometimes is something that you have to think about first and foremost beyond anything else. So again, not knowing the context of this aggressive behavior that the questioner was asking about, also make sure that your physical safety is taken care of, because that is not an insignificant thing. It's that whole thing of like, live to fight another day. So whatever scenario you're in, you know, again, reframe for yourself that it's about the other person, that behavior says more about them than it says absolutely nothing about you, but also what can you do about it? And whatever steps you're going to take, whether it's, you know, through HR or confrontation or whatever else it is, also make sure that you're, if it's relevant in that context, you're not putting your physical safety at risk.
Great, thank you. We have a question in the chat about combating imposter syndrome. And perhaps as you are building up your own success and your own trophy chest, what do you do at that moment afterwards? Would you feel like perhaps it isn't enough and maybe you are an imposter?
You know, I think we've overdone this imposter syndrome thing. And I think it's, to some extent, I get it. Like, believe me, there have been times where I have felt like, oh my gosh, I'm in over my head. But that's not being an imposter, you guys. Like, I think, again, especially women are constantly told, oh, you know, beware of imposter syndrome. It's imposter syndrome has gotten so much airtime that I think to some extent it's become a self-fulfilling prophecy where it's like, oh my God, I must have imposter syndrome. You know, and I imagine that in a lot of cases, that it's not actually imposter syndrome. It's just feeling a little bit out of your depth. So how can you combat that specifically? It's like, okay, well, I don't feel like I belong here. Again, get analytical about it. Why don't you think you belong there? Why don't you think you belong in that table or in that room or in that board meeting, whatever it is? Because to be honest with you, I mean, more often than not, you wouldn't have gotten an invitation if you didn't belong there. There's this great book by this VC founder named Arlen Hamilton. And the book is called It's About Damn Time. And she talks about this a lot. She was a Black woman who was homeless when she started her fund. All of those things, especially in the world of venture capital, are going to be huge strikes against her, right? But she did it, she made it happen. And she would be in these rooms with billionaires. And she was like, you know, you have to remind yourself that you belong in that room too. You're there for a reason. You got invited or you were forced or whatever it is, but wherever you feel like you're being an imposter and you don't belong, actually you kind of do, because otherwise how would you have ended up there? That's one. Two is it really imposter syndrome? Is it that thing of like fake it till you make it? Or actually, is it just that you don't have the experience yet? And if it's experience you lack, for example, you know, people feel like, oh, well, you know, am I putting out imposter syndrome? Or I feel imposter syndrome when I, you know, have to project a lot of confidence at a, I don't know, at a meeting or at a presentation. And then internally, I'm really scared. Everybody internally is really scared about some things, but you just find a way to power through, right? So I would say it's really less about sort of combating imposter syndrome and really focusing on, why do you think that imposter syndrome is there? What is it that you feel like you're being disingenuous about, or that you're feeling a little bit fake about? And more often than not, I think it's not about being an imposter or pretending you're someone you're not. It's just feeling uncomfortable. And if you feel uncomfortable, then dissect that and say, okay, well, I don't feel confident in front of a big room. Can I practice? What can I do to feel more confident doing public speaking? Is it that I don't feel like, you know, my business is good enough to actually get funding from these angels I'm pitching to? You know, what's specific? Again, make it very, very concrete and specific, and don't just sort of throw it to imposter syndrome. What is it that you feel like being imposter about? And then work to build up those skills that you think you need to have, so you feel more confident in the room. But also, it's again that bigger picture thing of reminding yourself that you belong there, because otherwise you wouldn't have been invited, you would have been asked, you wouldn't have been forced, you would have been pushed, whatever the situation is. I mean, you just have to, and at some point, but again and again and again, being in those rooms, you'll realize that actually, and Michelle Obama says this in her book, she's like, I have met with world leaders, CEOs, all of the big important people. And she's like, everybody wonders how they got to where they are. And if that's true for people at that level, then it's just a human problem. It's not a, you know, it's not an imposter thing. It's just like, but they all own it, right? They're all in the room. They all found a way to realize that actually I belong here for a reason. It's sort of having that, it's reminding yourself that, and then working on the practical stuff that will make you feel better about being there.
That's great. I think I'm also hearing, you know, something similar you said about bravery, how bravery is not being fearless. I think success is not being immune to discomfort.
No, you guys, the only thing that success is the results of discomfort. You know, and I think that's the thing, is whatever we do, again, we went to Chicago, and I know there are some people who might not have any affiliation to Chicago here, but like, you've done stuff before where you felt out of your depth. You've been in rooms before. And again, President Obama said this all the time, that he loved being the dumbest person in the room. If you feel like an imposter, use it as a learning opportunity. Use it as an opportunity to be like, wow, these are the people I think are the biggest brains, the biggest this, the biggest that. What can I learn from them? And you'll be amazed at how all of a sudden turning it less about yourself and feeling awkward and out of your depth and like you don't belong. If you flip it out and make it about them and what you can learn, then all of a sudden it's less of a thing of like being out of place and more of a basically like a research project. And you can even, again, if you feel uncomfortable interacting in those environments, you can even make it like, hey, I really admire X, Y, or Z thing that you've done, Mr. Person who I, you know, have blown up in my head to be so much more important than I am. Can you give me some tips? You know, and again, use it as a learning opportunity to take some of that bite out of being in that environment.
That's great. And I'll close out with this question, because you've shared a lot of really helpful study and toolkits and practice for building your own resilience. Yeah. But what advice do you have for people who are managers or in groups of other people of how you can cultivate resilience among teams or in groups of folks?
That's a great question. It's a couple of things. One is that annoying thing, but it's true, of leading by example. I think, you know, there's so much, you know, sadly, you know, organizations are still very hierarchical. And especially when there's times of uncertainty, of difficulty, of challenge, of, you know, choppy waters like we've all faced, people look to the leader or who they think is a leader. And sometimes that leader is a person who has a title, you know, that says leader in it. Sometimes it's someone on their team. But you have to model effectively what being resilient looks like. So then at least that calms the frantic energy a little bit, because they know, okay, well, if that person's not freaking out and sort of running around with their hair on fire, then it can't be that bad. So that's one thing, is really just sort of, you know, lean. I hate using the term leaning in, so, because it's such a fraught phrase, and I don't mean it in the Sheryl Sandberg sense, but I mean really leaning into the role of being a leader and modeling what resilience looks like in your own behavior. And then secondly, I think the other thing is actually just having really open and honest conversations, because I think it's important to remind everybody that everybody is scared. Again, depending on what the specifics are of the scenario, if your team is worried about a merger or about a big change or about, you know, name the elephant in the room, talk about it. Don't pretend it isn't there and act at all like, you know, again, burying your head in the sand, because everyone's thinking about it. And I have found that one thing about, like, if there's an elephant in the room, that's what you talk about. That is a hugely, hugely, hugely powerful thing to do, especially as a leader, because then everybody can just be a bit more open and honest about where they're at, what they're worried about, what's going on for them. And then again, you have very practical and very specific feedback to then work from as to, okay, well, this is how we can make it better. This is how we can improve. This is how we can protect ourselves. This is what we can do to move forward very specifically, instead of just acting like, oh, okay, we're going to tiptoe around this and pretend it doesn't happen. So as I said, first and foremost, sort of model the resilience for yourself, because it is very, very powerful, especially when things are scary and uncertain. People want to see other people who sort of have it under control and will take some comfort from that. But then secondly, you know, name the elephant, have open and honest conversations about, you know, what are you, you know, speaking to your team, what are you guys afraid of? What's going on in your heads? And then how can we very specifically and practically, you know, work to make some of those challenges or anxieties a little bit less so.
Great. Thank you so much. And thank you to everyone who submitted questions. I think this was a really great conversation. Well, I hope everyone can walk away with the notes you have for yourself, how you can use this. Give yourself 30 minutes on the calendar to do some of this self-study. I think we have a really good list of to-do things. Yeah. As a few notes, this session was recorded, so we will be sending that out to everyone who registered. Please feel free to share it with folks on your team, otherwise, it might be helpful. RuPaul does have a book coming out soon, so if you found any of this helpful, there will be more to read coming soon. Stay posted. And thank you again from the bottom of our hearts for this very helpful session.
It's a pleasure. Thank you so much, Linda. Thank you, everybody, for being here with me for this afternoon, for however long you've been able to stay. I know there have been some questions that you've probably got that you don't necessarily want to put out in a public forum or even a semi-public forum. So please feel free to reach out to me directly. The easiest way to find me is on LinkedIn. I'm just RuPaul Patel, and you can sort of see what I look like. So connect with me on LinkedIn and feel free to send me a message there, and I'd be happy to continue the conversation there. So thank you. And have a wonderful day to all of you.
Thanks so much. Take care.